Well, it's time to bring it on with your email questions. Pat, this first one comes from Tammy, who says, I work with a small group of women. We all work well together with one exception. She is poison. My manager realizes this but chooses to brush it off. I've confronted her and I've prayed for her, but I'm at a loss for what to do next.
Well, you might look at the Bible and show her what God said at the Tower of Babel. It says, this people have one mind, and they speak with one voice. Now, nothing they propose will be impossible. If you have a disruptive influence, you will not accomplish anything. The Bible says very clearly, drive out a scoffer, and strife will cease. You can't permit somebody who's a disruptive force to be in the middle of a group, because it breaks the cohesion. Instead of working together, all you're trying to do is defend yourself about this sharp-tongued woman. And if the manager doesn't see that, she's hurting herself. And maybe the answer is to say, look, you're going to kill your own chance of advancement, promotion, and everything else, because this group isn't working because of her. All right.
Okay, this is Cherish. That's a pretty name. I'm going through a nasty divorce. My husband is a non-believer and is leaving me. I know it says in 1 Corinthians 7:15 that if a non-believer wants to go, we should let them leave. At what point do the children come into play? I can understand the need for the kids to know their father, but is it wrong if I want full custody? I want to protect them from his abusive actions and behavior.
Well, there's nothing wrong at all. The Bible says if an unbeliever wants to depart, the brother or sister is not bound. Let him go. And the thing is, let him go. Now, you want the children. And the chances are, if he's as abusive as you say, he doesn't want the children, so he'll be glad to let you have them. But mothers always, I mean almost always, have precedence in a legal battle with children. Judges want to put children with their mothers because they're better at parenting of a young child than the fathers are, because the father's got to go work, etc. So I think you've got a good claim, and there's nothing wrong. Do you want the children? Of course. Get them.
Yeah. You know, one thing that is a word of wisdom to someone like this, I've seen this with my own friends, is to not badmouth the other parent, no matter how bad they are to your children, because it really impacts kids when they feel like one of their parents is.
They want to love mother and daddy.
They do.
They want to honor. They want to have a sense of honoring their father. And the idea that you're somehow getting an advantage when you are constantly harping about your father, it's very good advice, Terry. Absolutely.
Okay, this is someone named Terry, and they're asking.
That's not you.
It's not me.
All right.
But we'll listen to the answer. How close are we to the rapture?
Jesus said nobody knows. Even the angels don't know. He said even the Son, when he was here on earth, didn't know when he was going to come back. And so when he comes back, he'll come back. And what he says is, occupy till I come. So I think the answer for all of us is to win as many to the Lord, bless as many as we can, help as many poor as we can, and serve him while we can.
Yeah.
He says, you know, to the steward who, he said, when he finds you so doing, giving portions to your fellow servants, the one who does that will be blessed by the Lord when he comes back. So do what you can to help your fellows in the Lord, and I wouldn't spend a lot of time worrying about when the rapture is going to happen, because none of us know. Nobody can tell you. I don't care how many prophecy conferences you go to, they can't tell you. All right?
This is Esther, who says, I heard a story of a woman who said she died and went to hell. She said she was able to talk to some of the people in hell, and they said they were Christians but were sent to hell because they sinned by wearing jewelry, trousers, and how they did their hair. Ooh, I'm in trouble. Is there any legitimacy to this woman's testimony?
That sounds like the people in hell were old-line Pentecostals. That's right. You're going to hell, sister, you Jezebel, by that.
Okay. No more trousers.
No, that didn't happen. I don't care. Don't believe it. What's next?
Okay, this is Laura, who says, a question has come up in our Bible study, so I would like you to weigh in. Some people have said that the events depicted in the book of Job did not actually take place. Instead, they were an allegory. What do you think?
Well, Job is considered the oldest book in the Bible. It could be allegorical, but most everybody thinks it was real. There was a man named Job. He was a rich man. When they count the number of camels and donkeys you've got, it doesn't sound like an allegory, you know. But he went through these sufferings, but It could be partially allegorical because it speaks to permanent truths mm-hmm. about God's dealing with mankind, and I think in that case it's very good. So, regardless of whether allegorical or actual, it speaks to truth, and the truth is clearly biblical and clearly speaks to us today.
So what are we to learn from it, I guess?
Yeah, what we learn from it. But I wouldn't spend a lot of time worrying about the allegorical part because the truth is there. And it had enough veracity to it. I think it happened. But, you know, who's to say it? I mean, we're looking how many years? 2,000 plus 2,500, maybe 4,500 years ago, 4,000 years.
Wow.
Who knows?
Mm-hmm.
And none of us can prove it, so I wouldn't worry about it. All right.
Well, that's all the time we have for your questions today, but we thank you for them. We do love to hear from you.